Hey, what's going on? It's your boy Steven. Welcome to the channel, Magnify Jesus. It's a pleasure to have you yet again. On this channel, we talk about doctrine, we talk about theology. So let's get into it. Today, we're going to be chopping up just some baseline things that really need context to be added to them. One of my gripes, I would say, within the progressive church and progressive Christians is that instead of appealing to doctrine, instead of appealing to theology, what they kind of appeal to is feelings. It's like they do marketing on what people want to hear and what they want to be talked about, and then they talk about it. The various topics I've noticed are, what's the will of God for my life? What does God want me to do with my life? And then health and wealth. So these pastors are like, you know, you're entitled to health and you're entitled to wealth. So my gripes with these progressive churches that are seeker friendly and preach on these things, they don't ever get into doctrine and they don't ever cover like the gospel. Like, you need to be saved. You need to repent of your sins. You need to turn away from your sins. The Holy Spirit works in you to convict you of sin. And that is one way that you bear fruit. That is an evidence of the Holy Spirit that you are repentant of sin and that you're working on not turning back towards sin like a dog goes to its vomit. So those are my gripes in like 30 seconds, right? Now, when I hear these things from other churches, it's very important that after I hear them, that I compare them to God's word and that I compare them to mentors and fathers in the faith, because it's very easy to kind of get off task is what I might call it, because you'll hear something and it sounds good to the ear, but it has no beneficial value, has no nutritional value. So I'm going to use this as an example, and this is not a really, really bad example, but it is an example of the gripes that I have with the progressive church, the seeker-friendly church. You're not coming in the church and they're talking to you about sanctification. They're not talking to you about holiness. They're not talking to you about salvation. They're talking to you about your calling. You're going to be great doing this. This is your superpower. And they're talking to you about health. You should be healthy. And they're talking to you about wealth. You should be wealthy. If you came to Jesus, you should have these things. But these things couldn't be farther from the truth. When we look at Jesus, we can see very quickly, and all of his disciples that followed him, even the apostles, we can look and see like, hey, this was not a cakewalk. And this was not something that when they became a part of this family or fraternity, they didn't inherit health and wealth. If anything, they inherited persecution. And that's what Jesus says in the word, you know, you'll inherit persecution. And I think it's just important that we're able to just view the context and just let the context speak. That way we have an understanding of kind of what we're looking at. So today I'm just going to show you something real quick. I want you to be able to see this with me. And I want to use this as an example, as the one that I gave earlier. Okay. All right, here we go. I'm going to start with a video that popped up on my Facebook feed. I was like, why me? But it happened. Let's see here. Okay. All right. This is titled "Why We Need to Be Filled with the Spirit." It's from Lake Point Church. Here we go.
When it comes to this concept of, man, what does it mean to be filled with the Spirit? A lot of people, they tense up and they reject it because they've seen it put in bad packaging. So, for instance, you may have seen anytime somebody talked about being filled with the Spirit, and you're like, oh, that's going to be wild, insane.
I want to pause right here. He's about to say unhinged emotionalism. But people that say something like, oh, I don't want to be filled by the Spirit because I've just seen emotionalism, that is not a representation of the Holy Spirit. If you really are filled with the Holy Spirit, then you deal with conviction of sin. That is one of the fruits that you'll see that are being bared in front of you, like conviction of sin. So the stuff that he's kind of talking about is more seeker friendly. Like, oh no, this is something that's wild and outrageous. But it's like he's about to dumb it down and make it seem like, no, this is something that you want because it's going to help you walk in your calling. And everybody wants to walk in their calling. They want their superpower. Right. I'll let the video play.
Unhinged emotionalism, deifying emotions, and people turn into these people who, every, you know, it's just they lose control of their emotions and they interpret that experience as being filled with the Spirit. And you're like, I'm out. And can I just point something out to you from the Bible? It says, for you did not receive a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. So when somebody is filled with the Spirit in a unique way, they like get more based, not less. You become more like Jesus and you get power for your calling. That's a sign. That's what happens. When it comes.
Okay. So this is important to kind of break down, because when you see this type of thing, it makes it seem like, okay, so he gave us two different sides of the coin, I guess. One being unhinged emotionalism, and the other one saying, no, you want this. Trust me, you want this. It's not unhinged emotionalism. One gives you power for your calling. Now, everyone in the audience, based on the marketing that was done probably by the church, based on the audience, that everyone in the audience is going to say, yeah, I want that. I want the power for my calling. Give me my superpower. What is it? Is it to run fast? Well, let's be serious. That's not what this is at all. And he references 2 Timothy 1 verse 7. So I just want to go into context about 2 Timothy 1 verse 7. Before I do that, while his message is still fresh on your hearts, I want to show you a pastor that I greatly admire. And I want you to see more so what you should probably reference, I guess, the Holy Spirit, what does it mean to be filled with the Holy Spirit? Because he says we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Let's talk about what it means. And I think that will give us more of an understanding on the Holy Spirit in general, because the way he just described it, you're going to think like, yeah, superpowers. I need the superpower. I'm going to run fast. Okay. But here, we're going to break this down right here. Give me a second. Okay.
Well, as we have been very deeply entrenched in the ministry of the Holy Spirit in the 8th chapter of Romans, it occurred to me that we've been talking an awful lot about the work that the Holy Spirit does in us, and we really haven't said anything about our part of it, our responsibility. And so I thought for tonight, I would direct your attention to the 5th chapter of Ephesians and verse 18. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18, it reads, "Do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit." Be filled with the Spirit. Those of you who have been believers for a long period of time can remember when this was a main topic in the life of the church. Speakers spoke about it, preachers talked about it, Bible study leaders addressed it, books were written about it. But that seems to be in the far distant past. You very seldom hear any really careful teaching on the filling of the Holy Spirit, definitively and faithfully representing what Scripture intends to communicate. And again, I think that's partly because the charismatics have redefined this concept, redefined these terms, redefined the ministry of the Holy Spirit, and good people shy away from the truth because it exposes their error in many cases.
And just to pause him real quick, he just said that they kind of redefine it and they make it sound like they want it to sound. He's exactly right. That's kind of what I feel like we just heard. Now, he's going to break it down briefly. Bear with me.
He says that is not a reason to do that. It's all the more reason to be clear about the truth of what Scripture teaches. So let me read for the text from verse 18 down to verse 21, and we'll talk about that a little bit tonight. Ephesians 5:18, "And do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody with your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to God, even the Father, and be subject to one another in the fear of Christ." When it comes to the ministry of the Holy Spirit in the work of sanctifying the believer, we have talked in detail about what it is that the Holy Spirit does, conforming us to the person of Jesus Christ from one level of glory to the next as we gaze at the glory of our Lord.
Real quick, did you just hear how he described the Holy Spirit's work, that the Holy Spirit conforms us to be like Christ? That's way different from a seeker-friendly message that someone can preach to you with tight jeans on and a very expensive t-shirt. This is the Holy Spirit. Check this out. You need the Holy Spirit. Yeah, no, it's not the unhinged emotionalism. This is what you need. And this pastor who preaches nothing but sound doctrine literally says, hey, the Holy Spirit is conforming us to be like Christ. That is not fun to hear. Like, oh, that's the Holy Spirit's job? Okay, well, all right. That doesn't sound like something I'm excited about. I don't know if I want to give this Sunday. I feel convicted. Good. Glad you feel convicted. We all need the Holy Spirit in order to be convicted of sin. We'll let this play on for another 30 seconds.
We understand that sanctifying ministry of the Holy Spirit. Here is the one verse that I think more than any other, that is verse 18, defines that the responsibility that we as believers have. This is a command. First, there is a negative statement, don't get drunk with wine. And then a positive command, be filled with the Spirit. In the construction of the original language, it really could be read this way, be being kept continuously filled with the Holy Spirit.
Wow. Be continuously kept by the Holy Spirit. Like, it's almost like it's a continual process. It's the everyday process for us by being filled with the Holy Spirit. It's like conviction of sin every single day. It's not you did it once type of thing and it's over forever. You never need to do it again. You pay your taxes every year, you know. You get paid every week. Like, this thing is saying you're being kept continually by the Holy Spirit and you need to be committed to it every single day. That doesn't sound fun, but that pastor made it seem like, yeah, my calling, that's the thing the Holy Spirit is giving me the power to do. We're going to jump over to 2 Timothy in a second. Let me break down one more part of this real quick. I believe it's at the 8-minute mark. So bear with me. I'm going to make sure I get this right.
To be filled with the Spirit is to be permeated by the truth concerning Christ revealed in Scripture.
That sound nothing like that other pastor at all. The other pastor made it sound like this was something completely different. And I'm not trying to beat up on a pastor. I'm not trying to say this pastor does not know what he's talking about, although I'm kind of saying that. But the important thing is that we as believers, that we hear sound doctrine on a regular basis and we hear things that helps us to grow. We should not be conformed to the word, but we should be transformed by renewing our minds daily. That's what the Bible says. Being transformed and being conformed to be like Christ, like, this is the job of the Holy Spirit. This is what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit, not a superpower for your calling. Like, there's various ways that we can look at, like, what God's will is for us. But this is what that other pastor was saying. That's not it. I'm going to let this play out for like 30 more seconds.
To be filled with the Spirit is to be permeated by the truth concerning Christ revealed in Scripture. How do I know that? Because if you go back to Ephesians, I'll show you a little bit of a contrast. In Ephesians, we just read, be filled with the Spirit, and the result of it, we'll talk about in a moment, speaking to one another in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, singing, making melody with your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks. Verse 21, being subject to one another. Verse 22, the wives demonstrate being Spirit-filled in their subjection to their husbands. Husbands demonstrate being Spirit-filled in verse 25 by loving their wives.
Parents demonstrate being Spirit-filled in chapter 6, verse 1. Our children, rather, by obedience to their parents. And parents in verse 4, by not provoking their children to anger. Spirit-filled slaves are obedient. Verse 5, and Spirit-filled masters care properly for their slaves.
So when we really listen to what John MacArthur just said here, it's almost like he's showing these are the ways that you can kind of tell that people are being filled with the Spirit. Like, kids are being obedient to their parents, for instance. Let's hear a couple of the examples one more time.
By loving their wives.
So men are loving their wives.
Parents demonstrate being Spirit-filled in
chapter. Hold on. He said something real good.
Permeated by the truth concerning Christ revealed in Scripture. How do I know that? Because if you go back to Ephesians, I'll show you a little bit of a contrast. In Ephesians, we just read, be filled with the Spirit, and the result of it, we'll talk about in a moment, speaking to one another
in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, singing, making melody with your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks. Verse 21, being subject to one another. Verse 22, the wives demonstrate being spirit-filled in their...
And the wives do it by doing what?
Subjection to their husbands.
Subjection to their husbands.
Husbands demonstrate being spirit-filled in verse 25 by loving their wives.
By loving their wives.
Parents demonstrate being spirit-filled in chapter 6, verse 1. Our children, rather, by obedience to their parents.
Hey, this is more so what we need to hear as believers on a regular basis. We need to know, like, this is what I need to be doing. This is what it means to be filled with the Spirit. So I wanted to compare those two messages, and I want you to be able to spot a speaker-friendly message in a heartbeat. That way, a seeker-friendly message in a heartbeat. That way you're able to know, like, hey, is this person preaching sound doctrine? Is this something that can benefit me and help me to grow, help me to be transforming my mind? Is it renewing my mind in God's word? Or is it just fancy things that people are saying? I'm going to stop sharing here. And I'm going to take you to one more thing. Let's see. A lot of pastors, I'll say, they share these messages on like how to figure out what God's will is for your life. And although I'm not like hating on them for trying, one thing that is important to me is that we actually know what's being said when it comes to pursuing God's will for your life, and that we have an understanding of what we need to do. So when we look at this particular scripture, okay, we look at 1 Thessalonians 4. I'm going to break this down quickly, and I'm going to move on to my next verse, and then we're going to wrap this up. Finally, my brothers, we ask and urge you in the Lord Jesus that as you receive from us how you ought to walk and to please God, just as you're doing, that you do so more and more. For you know what instructions we gave you through the Lord Jesus, for this is the will of God, your sanctification. So if you were to just do a word search in the Bible and figure out what the will of God is for your life, you could start here and you wouldn't be wrong. The will of God for you is sanctification. That's it. Like, we can start there. If you're confused and you need a whole book from a heretic pastor that is not rightly divided in word of truth at all, you need to come back to God's sufficient word. It says that you abstain from sexual immorality, that each of you know how to control his body, his own body in holiness and honor, not in the passion of lust like the Gentiles who do not know God. Man, and I'll keep reading just because that each one of you know how to control his own body in holiness and honor. And that's funny because in my previous video, I talked about self-control. This is one of the ways that you show self-control. Not in the passion of lust like the Gentiles who do not know God, that no one transgress and wrong his brother in this matter, because the Lord is an avenger in all these things. As we told you beforehand and solemnly warned you, for God has not called us for impurity, but in holiness. Therefore, whoever disregards this, disregards not, but not man, but God, who gives his Holy Spirit to you. Wow. That is something else. Holiness. Who would have thunk that would probably be considered what God's will is for us? Holiness. That we be conformed to the likeness of Jesus Christ. I'm going to break this last part down and then I'm going to wrap this up. I don't want this video to be too long. I want people to watch at least 30 seconds of it. So at the end of this, we're going straight to 2 Timothy 1, because this is what the pastor mentioned in his breakdown of what Timothy was being talked to about. So when we look at 2 Timothy chapter 2 Timothy 1 verse 7, we're being introduced to Timothy and talking about like how he came to faith through his grandmother Lois and his mother Eunice. His father, I believe, was an unbeliever or Gentile. So verse 7 says, for God gave us a spirit, not of fear, but of power, love, and self-control. There's that word again, self-control. So we just saw how that contrasts with what we just read. That's one of the things that God calls us to do, and holiness is one of the things. But it's saying, don't be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share in suffering for the gospel of power, for the gospel by the power of God, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, and which is now manifested through appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Now, this is the interesting part to me. We're looking at what God's will is, and we're looking at the calling that we have, but really the calling is most likely for us to share the gospel with other believers. And the power that we have through the Holy Spirit is that the Holy Spirit is going to work on the other person's heart, really, to do all the work anyway. God does all the work. Paul says, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. And even in this case, we're not magically getting people saved because we share our testimony. Oh, I used to do this. I was on drugs, but God saved my life. And someone's going to give their life over to Christ. The gospel is the power that saves. What can we say more than God died on the cross, that Jesus died on the cross for our sins? What can we say more than that? He died on the cross for our sins, and he rose on the third day. Well, I was on drugs. That should definitely, no, it doesn't. It doesn't parallel. That is what we need to be sharing, the gospel. And these pastors of secret-friendly churches need to be sharing the gospel. The important thing here, though, is that we look at this verse that was used out of context, I believe, to say the power that we're going to get for God's will in our, or whatever we think God's will is for our lives. Well, when we really look at it, he was telling Timothy that God did not give us a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and self-control, because he was telling Timothy, hey, don't be ashamed of the gospel. I am suffering, okay? And I want you to suffer with me. I want you to share in this suffering, and it's because of Christ Jesus that we're suffering. And then he was saying, don't be ashamed of it, even though you're young, okay? Don't be ashamed of it, even though I'm being persecuted for it. I'm suffering for it. Don't be ashamed of it. Continue to preach it. There are many different ideologies that are being preached that are wrong, and you have to shut it down. Like, don't be afraid. God didn't give us a spirit of fear. We need to display power, love, and self-control. But when we look at this, this doesn't mean we're going to get a superpower. If anything, it means sustaining, you know, what and continuing to guard the deposit that was entrusted to you. Why is it so difficult for us to really look at scripture, really see kind of what the word is saying, and kind of leave it at that at times? I think it's because we feel like we got to add our own spin to it, and we have to run away with something to make it a tweetable moment, a quotable moment. We don't need any more quotable moments. We need to quote scripture. Okay. I'm saying this as much to you as I'm saying it to myself looking in the mirror. Like, we need to make sure that we are not making quotable moments, but that we're quoting scripture, because that is where the power to save is. It's in the scriptures. So God didn't give you a spirit of power, love, and sound mind for you to have a superhero power, for you to have super speed or super strength. It's basically guarding what was entrusted to you, having the power to do so, the love of God, self-control to be able to be in control of yourself. And honestly, when it came to what Timothy was dealing with, and when it came to Paul, when he was suffering, Paul is suffering and he's writing to Timothy. Timothy is seeing how Paul was treated, and he's like, I don't know. He's probably thinking, I don't know if I want to deal with that. And Timothy's like, Paul's like, hey, my son in the faith. Like, I see you as a dear son in the faith. Like, join with me in this suffering. Like, man, how many people want to hear that? Especially United States, where it's pretty cushy right now for Christianity. We're not really being attacked and persecuted when overseas people are being beheaded and stuff like that. So anyway, I just wanted to kind of break down the scripture real quick and be able to talk about that, because I just feel like it's really, really important that we be able to rightly divide a word of truth, that we be able to read the word and use the context to understand what it's saying. I'm going to read one thing in conclusion, then I'm done. In a concordance that I have by Daniel M. Doriani and Richard D. Phillips, it's the Reformed Expository Commentary on 2 Timothy and Titus. Here is a quick glimpse at what we're looking at here. So the context of everything that Paul was dealing with is kind of summed up in the closing thoughts. I'm going to read the paragraph before it. So since Christ's system, commentators see the contest between fear and power as a theme in 2 Timothy. Fear and power. Above all, the power of God can make Timothy strong. 2 Timothy 1:7-8. Living in fear appeals to some people. At a minimum, cowards take fewer risks. Timothy was afraid to probably preach the gospel, seeing how Paul was being treated. They asked less of themselves, but disciples have God-given power. 2 Timothy 1:7 also mentions love and self-control because God poured his love into our hearts. Romans 5:5. Pastors can love their people. Self-control, from the Greek word sophronismos, signifies self-discipline born of sober thought and a refusal to indulge in sin. How come this is not talked about whatsoever? Now, when I gave you the breakdown of self-control, I kind of broke down how abstaining from sexual immorality and that type of thing, like holiness, was like kind of a definition. But pastors don't get into that when they talk about the will of God. They talk about, you know, what powerful calling you have. But that's not it. This says it signifies a self-discipline born of sober thought and a refusal to indulge in sin. That's where we need to be looking at things as believers, a refusal to indulge in sin. Timothy needs self-control to keep working in the face of opposition, to keep studying scripture when weary, and to keep speaking when few listen. He was young, so people were despising his youth. But it was just important that Timothy continue to do what he was doing, guarding the gift that was given to him. Closing thoughts. We must learn from Paul's demeanor during unjust imprisonment. His confidence in God grants him peace. It grants us peace too. We also notice that imprisonment does not stop Paul. He keeps functioning as a leader by writing. How blessed are we if we do what we can, whatever our condition. Amen. So that's it for me. I wanted to be able to break down what the pastor said, what a sound pastor is preaching, and to be able to break down a verse that was used to kind of talk about power and our calling. That's not what it's saying at all. If we look at the context of the entire text, Paul is suffering, and we're talking about like kind of how to deal with suffering. And we're looking at a specific instance where Timothy needs to be like prepared to be like, hey, you need to join in my suffering. You need to preach the gospel. You need to really say what the word says, and you need to do it with power, love, and have self-control. Okay. All right. That's it for me. Thank you for joining me at the channel. This was a long video, but if you watched, thank you. Thank you for joining us at Magnify Jesus. Subscribe, hit that bell so you know when a new video is out. Like, comment. I'd love to hear from you. Okay. Have a wonderful day. Peace.